part five is the really cool stuff about cellular respiration. This is the kind of thing that allows us to be large organisms. The electron transport chain is the critical component when it comes to our energy use. Without it, as we'll see later, we're not going to be able to do to function as a big organism. So what is that, the electron transport chain? Well, clearly, you need to assemble a series of tools that allows you to pass electrons from one to the other so that these electrons essentially bounce down this energy hill. And we're setting this up in the inner membrane of mitochondria. The inner membrane. Now remember membranes. When I spoke to you about membranes before, I said these are basically your workbench. And nowhere does this become more apparent than when you're looking at the movement of electrons. You have to assemble all the parts for this process to work efficiently. At one end of that workbench is going to be your oxygen. That is your magnet. That is what gives you direction in this whole process. If you didn't have that, you wouldn't know which way these electrons could travel, but because the oxygen attracts them, you have a single direction that everything is going to flow into. Just like with gravity, gravity will always move you downwards. So the oxygen is going to pull the electron through the electron transport chain towards it. As they're being pulled, the electrons move through several of these electron acceptors, and each time they move, this amounts to a redox reaction. Because if you have the first one and it loses the electron, then the next one gains the electron, and that is oxidation and that is reduction. So you're now going through a series of redox reactions. The key thing about the energy part here, not just the movement of these electrons, is that the energy that they impart on their path, just like the tennis ball moving down the hill and it kicks the rocks and it kicks the leaves and so on, the energy it imparts on its pathway, that energy is going to be used for something. It is going to be used to move hydrogen ions across a membrane. That's the hydrogen ion pump. The hydrogen ions, those are H+. And if you remember, we had NADH. Well, there's your H. We talked about electrons. That's what's happening up here. The electrons are moving. But the H, what does the H do? Well, the H is actually going to be moved across this membrane. And it will become apparent in just a minute why this is a good thing. You're moving this hydrogen across the membrane, and all the way across that membrane, you're going to accumulate many, many hydrogen ions. If you accumulate many hydrogen ions, that is not equilibrium. I don't know if you remember, we talked about diffusion in chapter 5, diffusion. And in diffusion, what we're trying to do is we're trying to reach equilibrium. Well, the pumping of hydrogen ions is creating disequilibrium anywhere we look. It's going to create a strong gradient of hydrogen ions. There's going to be a whole bunch on one side of the membrane and very few on the other side. And this is what sets up our energy-making process. What they want to do, these hydrogen ions, is move back and create equilibrium. So there's a lot of pressure where there's all these hydrogen ions. This is like too many people on the bus. There's a lot of pressure. They would like to get off the bus. They would like to jump over to go back to the other side of that membrane. And we let them, but we only let them through if they jump across this particular enzyme, ATP synthase. Guess what it does? it synthesizes ATP. And so as we take one of these hydrogen ions and we're moving it through the ATP synthase to the other side of the membrane, that's how we make ATP. That's the process by which we can make ATP. There's an analogy to this, of course. If you think of how water flows, water is being pulled by gravity, so it flows downhill. Now you can stop the water flow. You can stop it by damming it up. And if you do that, you're going to accumulate a lot of water behind this dam and a lot of water pressure. So ultimately, the flow is going to be a very important part of this. Flowing hydrogen ions, just like water flowing, is allowing you to tap into their kinetic energy. Flowing, that means movement. That's kinetic energy. And so the kinetic energy from that hydrogen ion flow, that's what allows ATP synthase to make ATP. This process is called chemiosmosis. Regular osmosis was when we had water move to create equilibrium. And chemiosmosis is because it involves a variety of other chemicals, not water. And that's why we call this process chemiosmosis. If you've ever been to a place like Hoover Dam, you'd realize how hydroelectric power is made, because that's a huge facility for that. In this case, you are damming the water, as I've mentioned. And because you're damming it, it means there's a huge pressure of the water on the dam. And then you selectively allow the dam water, the dammed water, to run through the dam through turbines, and the movement of the water is going to turn the turbines. The kinetic energy of the turbines is going to help us make electricity, and then of course once the water gets out at the bottom, it doesn't have that much pressure anymore and it just sort of trickles down the hill. And that's basically what happens in hydroelectric power generation, and this is very much analogous to that process. Now here's what that looks like. This diagram has a certain amount of complexity to it, and so it's important that we first of all orient ourselves. Where exactly are we? So on the top you can see a mitochondrion. There is an outer membrane that goes all the way around, so this is the outer membrane. And then here we have the inner membrane, which is the one that provides us with the workbench space. So the inner membrane of the mitochondrion is our workbench. And on this inner mitochondrial membrane, we are going to arrange our tools. Let's call these tools 1, 2, 3, and 4. So we have four important tools. Some of these are composed of more than one part. As you can see, this one here has two little hydrogen electron acceptors. This one has 1, 2, 3. This one has 2. And all of these are lined up so that electrons can travel. The NADH arrives and brings in the hydrogen ion. There's the hydrogen ion. So that pops off and moves there. And the electrons, the electron flow, they are given into this membrane system, and they're being picked up by number one. Now once they reach the electron carrier inside of number one, they start to do their trip. Bounce, bounce, bounce. Oxidation, reduction, oxidation, reduction, oxidation, reduction. So you can see there are multiple successive redox reductions going on. And once the electrons flow all the way down this energy hill, you end up with oxygen. There's oxygen. Oxygen is pulling this process to itself, pulling the electrons down. And because there are some hydrogen ions here, hydrogen ions with the oxygen are going to make water. Now, earlier in the citric acid cycle, and just before, we made carbon dioxide. That was one output from cellular respiration. And if you remember, we started that with glucose. So the glucose is where the carbon dioxide comes from that you exhale. The glucose is what gives you the carbon dioxide. The electron transport chain is what gives you the water. So that's where the two outputs, the main outputs, the things you breathe out, come from. Let's take another look at this. One of the things I said is that as the electron moves, it imparts a little bit of energy on its path. The energy that this electron gives up as it moves from here to here to here, that energy is driving this hydrogen ion pump. So this whole thing, number one, includes electron carrier molecules, and it also includes a hydrogen ion pump. The next one, same thing. Two more hops, hydrogen ion pump. Two more hops, hydrogen ion pump. And so the end result is you have all these hydrogen ions on top and very few at the bottom. They're always going to be very few at the bottom because both the pump and this uses them up. Now the ones on top, they would like to move back down to the other side of this membrane, and they don't have any place to do it except at the level of this ATP synthase, number four. So ATP synthase is a complex enzyme that's also embedded as tool number four in this membrane. And the hydrogen ions, as they fall, they impart their own kinetic energy onto this enzyme, and this actually rotates. As the hydrogen ions fall, it rotates. It rotates kind of like click, one ATP is made. Next hydrogen ion, click, another ATP is made. Another one, click. So every time this clicks over, it makes us ATP. And as you can imagine, accumulating all these hydrogen ions up there is going to allow you to produce a lot of ATP. And so that's what happens in chemiosmosis. It tells you right there how this process works. It has all those electron carriers embedded. And the only thing that I still have to tell you about is this little thing here. Whoops. Don't know why it does that. This here is a skull and crossbones. And the question is, why is that there? Well, this is one place where you can stop this process cold. If you have another kind of molecule, something like cyanide, that's cyanide, and cyanide plugs this up because A, it does not give these electrons direction, and B, it does not allow these hydrogen ions to flow across the membrane. So very quickly, you can stop the metabolic activities. And you've probably heard this from spy stories on TV. They always have a cyanide capsule somewhere, right? And that's because when you stop this process, your body will run out of energy very, very quickly. It's not a matter of breathing. This is just a matter of plugging up all these electron transport chains. And our body can't survive without that energy. Now, adding up the ATP from cellular respiration is an interesting task, and it's a little bit surprising. The reason why is because of the output. So we've already gone through all the stages here, and we remember that two ATP are created in glycolysis by direct synthesis, and this was the substrate level phosphorylation. And again, in the citric acid cycle, we had substrate level phosphorylation create a little bit more ATP. And then we get a huge amount of ATP through the electron transport chain. Now, it says here about 34 ATP. The reason why it says about 34 ATP is because this is not exact in terms of how many electrons are going to flow for each ATP. The electrons are going to flow all the time, and some of that electron flow is going to create enough for one ATP. And some of it is going to create enough for the second ATP and so on, but it's not an exact one-to-one relationship. So if you add that all up, you're going to end up with 38 ATP. Now, what does that mean? If you remember, ATP is adenosine triphosphate. And so if you have ADP, that's adenosine diphosphate, and the third phosphate group, this is the one that's the high energy bond, right? The last one there. So what you have done when you make 38 ATP is you have created 38 of these bonds. 38. Now, if you look at glucose and you do an accounting of how many bonds there are in glucose, and you were to attach all the little bits and pieces, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, there's a double bond O, and then you have H, O, H, H, and so on, you'll find out that in glucose there are 24 bonds. 24 bonds. Now, if you thought about this before we started the process, you'd say, ah, we're going to make a transfer of energy from the bonds in the glucose to the bonds in the ATP, right? So you'd say, okay, how many bonds are there? Well, there's 24 bonds in the glucose. Maybe we'll get 24 bonds on ATP. That would be 24 ATP. Ah, but wait. We have the second law of thermodynamics to consider, so we always lose some energy and energy transfer. So maybe 24 bonds in the glucose give us 22 bonds for 22 ATP. And yet we end up with 38. That's one of those surprises, that not only are we more efficient than our combustion engine, because it blows things up, we are so efficient that we're ending up with more bonds than we could reasonably expect. Do you follow that argument? We end up with 24 and 38. How can you have 24 covalent bonds turn into 38 covalent bonds? Well, this is how. So each bond is obviously not exactly the same in terms of its energy, but you're still extracting a greater benefit than what you could expect. And so this is a neat thing with the electron transport chain. It's that little bit of biochemical wonder that you get sometimes when you're studying these processes. This is unexpected. But it is the unexpected in this case that allows the unexpected, a body like ours, to operate. If we did not have that level of efficiency, we wouldn't be able to let this body run. So we would run out of energy.